in Bangladesh, a senior cleric and almost 200 others have been arrested for inciting the mass unrest that quickly turned deadly earlier this week. Police and more than 200,000 hardline Islamists said they have been mired in running battles for days over violent demands to make blasphemy a crime punishable by death. The government's refusing to budge, though, with police reportedly deploying live ammunition. Islamist factions are also demanding 12 other amendments that would enshrine Sharia principles into law. Let's get more perspective now on the violence raging in there and the region at large with Bidit Day, a lecturer at Britain's Northumbria University and a campaigner against war crimes. Mr. Day, these protests have brought Bangladesh to a standstill. How have these Islamists caused such disruption?
Actually, you have to go back to the history of the subcontinent. In 1947, the subcontinent was divided into two parts, as you know, and the Muslim majority became Pakistan. The other part became India, obviously. In 1971, actually, Bangladesh emerged from the then East Pakistan with a view to establishing secularism and linguistic nationalism. However, these fundamentalist right-wingers who opposed the independence of Bangladesh actually conspired from the very outset of the country. They couldn't reconcile with the fact that with the demise of Pakistan, and they never accepted the secular identity of Bangladesh. And for the last 42 years, they have been actually conspiring against the ethos of a secular state, and they are trying to convert it to another state like Pakistan. They are trying to make this an ungoverned state by creating anarchy. And whatever you are seeing right now is actually a result of all these attempts they have been organizing for the last 42 years.
But then you have over 200,000 people joining in these riots. Doesn't that give them some kind of influence? I mean, how big they've become?
Actually, you have to see two facts here. First of all, there are like thousands of religious education institutes across the country, which were actually funded by the Middle Eastern countries over the last 40 years, and they have been allowed to grow and mushroom. And there are 4 million students who go to those schools because of poverty and many other reasons. And what these fundamentalists are trying to do is to exploit these children. It was very sickening to see that. Many of these demonstrators, perhaps thousands of these demonstrators, are teenagers and underage children, and it was quite frustrating, first point. And the second point is some of the major political parties, including the main opposition party, has been supporting it, including Jamaat Islami, who have been actually taken to the war crimes tribunal. I mean, many of its top brass leaders have been taken to the war crimes tribunal. So thereby, what you see, this number, I still have to say that do not represent the majority of Bangladeshis. Mm.
So let's take a look at, in terms of the reports that we've been seeing and some of the pictures we're seeing, the police aren't holding back. Won't that steer public sympathy, even though the majority of people are not necessarily agreeing with the Islamists, but given that they do have given themselves a platform that people are steering towards them, won't that give them more sympathy?
I'm afraid. I mean, the first thing is that you just mentioned about the 13 points demand for Hifazat Islam, and they cannot coexist with Bangladesh. Bangladesh and these 13 points are mutually exclusive. If you have to accept the true spirit of Bangladesh, you have to throw it out of the window. So majority of the people in Bangladesh, they do know about it. Yes, the sympathy is there. We know that these are the poor people who have been wrongly motivated, who have been misdirected by their teachers or leaders, and the main opposition party, if effectively ditched them. They extended their support initially, but when the children were out in the street, they actually turned around. So yeah, we feel sympathy for them, and any loss of lives is always unacceptable. But still, yeah.
Mr. Bidet, I'm afraid I'm going to have to leave it right there with you, but thank you very much for your time and your insight in this subject. Mr. Bidet from Northumbria University and campaigner against war crimes.